This month's Mainsail sees us in Sorrento, Australia. We're at the Moth Worlds and we're looking at the history of a very specific design concept that has revolutionized the sport of sailing, foiling. To get to the bottom of foiling as a concept, we're going to have to simplify things quite significantly. Let's start real basic. Imagine a child's drawing of a boat with the hull, the platform, and a power source, the sail. Simple so far, but there's one thing missing from this picture. For the sail to move things forward rather than sideways, we need a counterforce. And in traditional yachts, that's created by a keel with a heavy lead bulb that keeps the boat upright, balancing the force of the wind on the sails. There are plenty of other forces at work that affect the way the boat can then move. There is, for example, drag from the sail. Modern design eliminates as much of this as possible with new technology. And then, of course, there's friction, drag in the water. The hull moving through the dense water, slowing the boat down. Imagine, though, if you could replace that heavy keel hanging below the boat with something far more efficient, something that lifted the hull clear of the water, eliminating the friction and unlocking a whole new potential for speed. That, in a nutshell, is foiling. In actuality, though, it's a very complicated concept, and to really get to the bottom of it, we're going to have to go back to school. The University of Southampton in the UK boasts the leading faculty in foil development and design. They work with some of the top America's Cup teams and run a state-of-the-art facility. What they don't know about foiling, quite simply, isn't worth knowing.
The simplest way to describe it is you could imagine a big wing, or like an aircraft wing, above the boat, lifting it up. If you go fast enough, you'll lift up like a plane. If you then put that wing underwater, the density of water is 1,000 times that of air. Therefore, the force on the foil is 1,000 times. So you can have a much, much smaller foil, and it'll generate the same amount of lift, vertical force, as a huge aircraft wing would.
Part of the reason why foiling has taken a while to be adopted in sailing is because you have to be going fast enough for the lift to pull you out of the water, so you need some minimum speed. But then also, if you start going too fast, then you'll become unstable. The balance here between the drag force and the lift force is critical, because we're lifting the boat out of the water, which is good, but we're replacing it with this drag of the foil, so we want to minimize that drag as much as possible. As we overdo it in one direction or the other, the whole system is going to start changing and we'll have bad flow behind the foil and we'll slow down.
And what would happen?
Practically what will happen is that this foil will start being so difficult to pull through the water that you'll have just as much resistance as you had before you were foiling, and you'll come crashing down to earth and slow down, and the whole thing will reset again.
So Joe, what can you do in this facility in relation to foils?
So this is a towing tank, which is a shared facility between us and Solent University. And here we can tow along an object through.
The ship science faculty has been researching all aspects of naval architecture, including foil design, since 1968. And although, as we've seen, the concept has been around for a long time, it's only comparatively recently that it's been successfully applied to sailing.
And that allows us to measure the resistance of any object.
When people talk about, you know, boats flying, about boats foiling, they imagine there's some sort of magic engine under the water, but that's not quite the case.
No, so what we've got is that the foils aren't pushing the boat along at all. What they're doing is they're lifting the boat up out of the water, which removes the resistance of the hull. So you're essentially taking away part of the resistance that was there with the hull, but you still have the resistance of the foil. But because foils are very efficient and they produce very low drag to a lot of lift, you get a much smaller resistance for the same amount of vertical lift that the hull was generating through buoyancy.
I mean, what do you think of the moths, and what do they show us?
So the moth is a great example because it's about as light as possible. And so it's a great place to start from, because you can use very small foils to balance out that weight. And also because it's so light, then by the sailors shifting their body weight, they can help control this process.
Where do you think we've seen the most advanced application within the sport of sailing?
Well, I guess the current generation of America's Cup boats are the kind of most extreme example of that. They need to generate a lot of power. So to do that, they have to have a huge wing sail, but they still have to keep the weight really low, otherwise they wouldn't be able to lift. So it's the advanced materials, the carbon fiber, the kind of extremely low weight design that allows them to generate this huge amount of power and transmit that through the boat. You know, they're really achieving some incredible things.
New Zealand almost capsized.
Oh my gosh.
This is just astounding.
The Stars and Stripes say it all. The comeback of 2014 is complete. America's Cup will stay in America.
Amongst those achieving great things as a pivotal member of Oracle Team USA was Tom Slingsby. The reigning Olympic gold medalist in the laser class, he first tasted moth racing in 2008 and has honed his skills on these tiny boats ever since.
I was the only person who had ever hydrofoiled when I joined Oracle Team USA, and I was able to bring in a bit of knowledge on how the foils work, how to finish the foils, what sort of shapes might benefit us in the America's Cup. And when we're learning how to hydrofoil, it was, I look back at it, it was probably the scariest time of my life. We didn't know what we were doing. We're sort of breaking new ground and trying to figure out how to control this thing. And we were doing some testing on San Fran Bay with Oracle Team USA, and we kept popping out of the water and having short doses of flight. And I remember sitting there thinking, how can a boat this big even go up for a few seconds? It's too big, it's too heavy. And then we saw, obviously, the Kiwis were foiling around and they were doing it with stable flight. That was a real eye-opener. And then the way it developed and how we all learnt the learning curve and how good we got at flying these 72-foot cats around was just amazing to be part of.
There's no way back, is there? I mean, we're never going to go back to displacement sailing in the carpets.
I don't think so. I think we're now so spoiled. We've learned how to hydrofoil all different types of boats, and it's just the way of the future for sailing. And I still love going and sailing a normal yacht that just sails around with the keel on. But I think this new way, it's definitely very exciting, and I think hopefully I'll be involved in this part of the sport for a long time.